I am Paul Nunes, and I'm the Global Managing Director of the Accenture Institute for High Performance. It's a global think tank with offices in Mumbai, São Paulo, Beijing, Boston, and London.
Yeah. The theme of the day, of course, is innovation. If I can ask you first a general question, what does the word innovation mean to you?
Well, I like to keep it simple. I think innovation is change that adds value. And it's really not more complicated than that. It's really about how we create value for folks by doing new things.
Yeah, and you say, I like to keep it simple. Do you think, do some people make it too complex?
Sometimes, I think, and particularly when we talk about disruptive innovation, because I like to focus on disruption. And oftentimes people worry about whether incumbents have to win or lose for something to be disruptive. I think any time that we're doing something that adds value for the customer, we're disrupting and we're adding innovation.
Yeah, and when you talk about disruptive innovation, can you give me an example of a company that does that in a good way?
Sure, there's lots of companies, some right here in the Netherlands. One that's disrupted itself is Philips. And if you think about LED lighting, incandescent lighting was going away. Everybody sort of knew it. And now Philips has taken the lead and the charge in doing the next wave of technology in lighting.
Yeah. You of course, over here there are a lot of small and new companies, but you work with a lot of big companies as well. That's a big theme at the moment. How does a big company innovate in a rapidly changing world? What does a big company need to be able to do that?
Well, one of the things a big company has to do is to have foresight and has to look deeper into the future. What we see is that the early adopters are going away. So you can't just look for small companies that are starting up that are doing well and then wait till they get established and buy them perhaps or compete with them later. That's what big companies used to do. Today, by the time a small company is successful, it's going to be very, very successful. And there's a lot of reasons for that.
Yeah, so for example, the Ubers of this world, the Airbnbs of this world, in no time they are from small companies.
Exactly. The reason for that, we say, is what we call Big Bang disruption, which we're talking about here today and is coming up. And it's because things can be cheaper and better at the same time through technology. And that's what these new innovators are offering, is really the perfect solution many times and the only obvious solution for the customer.
Yeah. So is the internet, digital technology, is that the most important factor of the change of this world?
Well, it's really important and it's core, and for two reasons. One is the natural costs of the technologies are coming down, and not just because of the chips, but for lots of other things, accelerometers, the things, GPS, all those things you see in your phone. But also the technology is driving down the costs of lots of other things. We're seeing offshoring and cheaper costs in manufacturing all around. So. Major cost decline, major advantage for differentiation and improvement.
Yeah. If you would start a company now, say, what are the ingredients to be a disruptive company?
Yeah. Well, I think one of the big changes, and we talk about innovation, is the move from design, pure design and creation, to what we call combinatorial innovation. And you'll see some of that today. It's where we're able to use the power of things like the internet to combine pieces, to combine off-the-shelf parts in lots of different ways. And what it really does is it democratizes innovation. It allows anyone to be an entrepreneur simply by using the parts that are available worldwide and to recombine them in new and different and creative and fantastic ways.
Yeah. Some people say in the future we will have, say, big or valuable companies, but they won't be big in size. Are the big companies going away, in your view?
Scale remains important. I would think there's sort of two types of businesses, two types of work. There's asset intensive, where we still need the factories, we still need to make things. And then there's asset light, which is things like design and invention. So some companies are getting smaller, but others are going to have to retain their scale in order to provide worldwide support. And so as innovation is rapidly demanded, word of mouth, social media, companies need to scale up quickly, and really only the incumbents have the established base to allow rapid scaling.
Yeah, working worldwide as you do, Do you see differences, or are the innovative companies of today, do they have the same elements everywhere in the world?
We think they have some of the same elements. One of the things that they do is they see deeper into the future and they look for the inevitable, we call the inevitable future. They don't satisfy themselves with sort of incremental solutions. We see them paying a particular attention to scaling, also how they make the best use of assets and get out of assets quickly when an innovation becomes obsolete, and then also about how they repurpose their offerings into different industries. So those would be four of the things that innovators today, I think, have in common.
Yeah. Is there still room for localization as well?
Oh, very much so, and that goes even to the combinatorial innovation part. Oftentimes you can start with an entity, with an offering, and then local folks can put different pieces and parts on it. So you see that all over in India and in China, where we tailor and we customize. Because of the modularity of so many of today's offerings, we can simply add some things, take some things off. We have a new offering customized to a particular segment or market.
How do you innovate your own company?
Oh, well, we work on the basis of the principle that all three strategy dimensions have to be attacked simultaneously today, and that's the nature of a Big Bang disruption. So you have to be differentiated, and we use technology to do that. You have to be low cost. Every company has to get to the base of cost, so we focus on that as well. And we focus on customer service, customer intimacy, which is the traditional third lever of strategy, and how you deliver the blend of that all at the same time.
Yeah. What does a country need to be you can say what does a company do, but what does a country need to be innovative to make it possible for companies to grow to?
Well, the recent article by Michael Porter in HBR in the Harvard Business Review talks about systems of systems. And I think that's where countries and industries partnering and working together to create integrated systems of systems is where the new competitive advantage is going to come. And so those new types of ecosystems where the industry lines have blurred, but we have new platforms, new companies helping each other. And that's what a country can bring to the competitive.
When you as a man with who knows what's happening around the globe, how do you look upon the Netherlands as an innovative country?
Well, I think the Netherlands is fantastic, and we're going to see it today. 800 innovations, which is only the start of what's being evaluated here today. 100 or more leading innovators for the role of innovator of the year from large and small companies. So a tremendous amount of innovation going on. And the Netherlands has a wonderful base of technological capability from which to build from. So I think it's a real hotbed of innovation, and we're going to see a lot more things.
And is there, one innovative company or here today that you know of, that is maybe is going to be a prize winner later on, a company that you like?
It's a great question, but I can't answer it. I think one of the things that's worst about these things is that only one can win, and really there's so many winners here. And I think everybody here is a winner in the fact that they've tried and clearly they've succeeded. Yeah. So you can't pick a single winner, really.
Can the idea of the Accenture Innovation Awards be something that's going to be a worldwide thing, happening in different countries, happening globally maybe?
Perhaps. We hope so. Again, it's a function of continuously innovating ourselves. And so we hope, because the success here today makes it a real possibility.